Diffusion models excel in many applications, such as generating beautiful images from text, animating a person, creating videos, and 3D models. We are going to learn and understand how diffusion models work. In this video, we'll cover four main topics: training, guidance, resolution, and speed. Let's start with a simple Gaussian distribution for easy sampling. We want to design a generative model translating these noise samples into high-quality images. More specifically, we want to find the parameters of this decoder that can transform a simple Gaussian distribution into a complicated natural image distribution. However, we do not know what the true data distribution is and can only approximate it by collecting lots of data samples. Our training goal is maximizing the sample probability, known as maximal likelihood. Let's see what this maximal likelihood is trying to do. We first apply a log function to simplify the expression, turning the product into a sum. This helps us rewrite it as an expectation. Here is the definition. If we subtract a constant that has nothing to do with the parameter theta, we find that this is just the KL divergence between the distribution from our generative model and the data distribution. So maximizing the likelihood means minimizing the similarity between these two distributions. Sounds great, but it's hard to compute this local likelihood value. Either it involves integrating out all latent variable z's or assuming that we know the ground truth latent encoder. Let's see what we can do. We first introduce an encoder capturing the latent variable probability given an observation. This term is 1 since we integrate out all latent variables z. Let's move the local likelihood inside the integral and express this as an expectation. Here, we can apply the base rule and multiply a dummy term. Next, we swap these posterior probability terms and separate them. We now recognize the second term is the KL divergence between our encoder Q of z given x and the ground truth encoder P of z given x. We don't know this value because we don't have the access to the ground truth encoder P of z given x. But we do know the KL divergence is non-negative. This means that the first term is the lower bound of the log likelihood value. Since the log likelihood measures the statistical evidence for our model, this term is known as evidence lower bound, or ELBO. One type of latent variable models is variational autoencoder, where they parameterize both the encoder and the decoder as a neural network. We can train both the encoder and decoder by maximizing the ELBO. Diffusion models are also latent variable models, but instead of encoding the observation x in one step, encode the image in multiple steps by progressively adding more and more noise. Similarly, the decoding process progressively removes the noise to generate a sample. In VAE, we have observed variable x and latent variable z. Similarly, in diffusion models, we call the clean image x0 and the latent x1 to xt. We can train a diffusion model in the same way as we train a VAE, by maximizing the evidence lower bound. Okay, let's first take a look at what the encoding process looks like. We can write the encoding process as a product of transition probabilities. We define the transition probability at each time step as a Gaussian distribution, where the mean is the image from the previous time step xt minus 1, scaled by a scalar that's less than 1, and some variance. This encoding process ensures that the latent variables become Gaussian noise after many time steps. So, with some derivation, our objective has three terms: prior matching, reconstruction, and denoising matching. The first term says that the latent distribution will be similar to the Gaussian distribution at the end of the diffusion steps. This is automatically satisfied by our forward diffusion process. The second term is similar to the reconstruction term in variational autoencoder and is simple to compute. I want to focus on how we can maximize this denoising matching term, or minimize this one. Here we see three probability distributions. First, what's the probability of a noisy image at time step t given a clean image? All we know is the transition probability of xt given xt minus 1. To do this, we need to know the reparametrization trick. This trick helps rewrite a random variable x as a deterministic function of a noise variable epsilon. Intuitively, we can represent the Gaussian distribution by scaling the epsilon by the standard deviation and shifting the mean. With this trick, we can express x1, x2, and so on. Plugging x1 into the second equation leads to this expression. Now we can simplify this because the sum of two independent Gaussian variables is also a Gaussian. Doing this recursively, we can write the noisy image at time step t as a function of clean image x0 and noise variable epsilon. This means that we can directly sample xt from this Gaussian distribution. The second term says the following. Suppose we know the clean image x0 and the noisy version of it after t forward diffusion steps. What's the probability of a less noisy image xt-1? This tells us how to denoise a noisy image when knowing the ground truth clean image x0. We use this to guide our denoising network that models the probability of a less noisy image xt-1 given a noisy image xt. Here is an actual photo of what's happening when training a diffusion model. To derive this term, we apply the definition of conditional probability and Bayes' rule. Here, we know exactly what these three probabilities are. After some calculation, we find that it is also a Gaussian distribution. The mean lies on the line between the noisy image xt and the clean image x0. We can also compute the variance in closed form. Here, the probability from our denoising network is also a Gaussian. Since both are Gaussian distributions with the same variance, minimizing the chaos divergence terms is equivalent to minimizing the distance between the means of the two distributions. The process looks like this. We sample a clean image x0 from the dataset and a noise image from a Gaussian distribution with zero mean and univariance. We encode a clean image with forward diffusion to get a noisy image xt. We then compute the L2 loss between the predicted and ground truth mean. By looking at this training objective, we can have three interpretations. First, from the ground truth mean, we see a linear combination of noisy image xt and clean image x0. But why do we ask the denoising network to predict noisy image xt that we already know from the input? Therefore, we express the estimated mean as the form of the ground truth one and only ask the model to predict the clean image x0. Second, from the forward diffusion process, we know the relationship between the noisy image, the clean image, and the added noise. We can express the clean image x0 as a function of a noisy image xt and the noise epsilon. When we plug this in, we arrive at this new form of ground truth mean. Similarly, we can match the form of the estimated mean with the ground truth one and only ask the denoising network to predict the noise. To discuss the third interpretation, we need to use the Tweedy formula. The formula states that if we observe a sample z from a Gaussian distribution, the posterior expectation of the mean is the sample plus a correction term involving the gradient of the local likelihood or the score of the estimate. Let's apply the formula to our forward diffusion probability. Replace the mean here, and we now have this expression. When we replace the clean image x0, we arrive at this equation involving the score. Similarly, we can parameterize our mean estimate using the same form. How can we compute this score? From a simple derivation, it turns out it's just the noise multiplied by the negative scalar. Intuitively, since the noisy image xt comes from adding the noise to the clean image x0, moving the opposite direction of the noise to denoise the image naturally increases the log probability. Here's the formulation of score-based models. Let's visualize the process in a simple 2D plot. We take a clean image x0 from our training dataset, select a time step t, and scale the clean image. We then sample a random noise and scale it. Adding these two up gives the noisy image xt. We can train the diffusion model to remove all the noise and directly predict the clean image. However, this is challenging, so the denoised image may still be low quality. So instead, we only take a small step along this line. Alternatively, we can ask the network to predict what noise has been added to this image and take an opposite direction for a small step. Or we can ask the network to predict the score. In all three cases, we arrive at exactly the same distribution for the less noisy image xt-1 given a noisy image xt. We can sample from this distribution and repeat the process. This allows us to create a path from noise to clean image. After training our diffusion model, we can use the denoising network to generate many samples. This is called unconditional generation. But perhaps we want to ask the model to generate specific contents, like cat images. Or if we want to see more cats wearing sunglasses using a text prompt. Let's revisit the score estimation interpretation of diffusion models. At time step t, we use our denoising network to predict the log likelihood gradient, which is the direction to maximize the log probability. For conditional generation, we want to predict the conditional score. By applying the Bayes rule, the conditional score consists of unconditional score and an adversarial gradient of a classifier. We can scale the adversarial gradient by a positive factor of gamma. This is great because we can reuse the unconditional model and use an additional classifier to guide the generation. We call this classifier guidance. But we'll have to train another classifier because an off-the-shelf classifier is usually trained with clean images. Luckily, we can use the predicted noise to estimate a clean image. This estimated clean image is a bit blurry, but off-the-shelf classifiers are usually fairly robust to this. This is nice, but do we really need to use an additional classifier? By applying the Bayes rules to the second term, we see that it consists of a conditional and an unconditional score. Plugging it back to our equation, we get a classifier-free guidance. But training two denoising networks is expensive, so we train a single conditional denoising network and use no condition to represent the unconditional model. Here's the comparisons between unguided and guided samples with classifier-free guidance. How do we generate high-resolution images? There are probably three types of methods. The first one is using cascade. We first use a diffusion model to generate a low-resolution image, say 64x64. We then train a separate diffusion model that upscales the low-resolution image to a higher resolution. The second type of approach is latent diffusion model. We first train a variational autoencoder that encodes a high-resolution image into a low-resolution latent code. We train both the encoder and decoder using the reconstruction loss, some with adversarial loss to ensure sharp results, and a regularization loss on the latent. Now we can train our diffusion model efficiently in the latent space. Once we get a clean latent, we use the decoder to map it back to a high-resolution image. In both cascade and latent diffusion models, we need to train several models separately. End-to-end methods aim to generate high-resolution images with a single diffusion model. Several promising ideas have been proposed, such as adjusting the noise schedules for high-resolution image generation, multi-scale loss, and progressive training. Diffusion models are very slow because we need to evaluate the denoising network several hundreds or even 1,000 times to get a good sample. Here are some methods that accelerate the sampling to make the diffusion models more practical. Let's first review the training objective of DDPM. We train our denoising network to predict the noise. If we look at this training objective and don't care about what the waiting term is, we just need to ensure that the forward diffusion model remains the same. The mean of the ground truth denoising step is a linear combination of the noisy image XT and the added noise epsilon. The mean of the estimated mean is of the same form. These three constraints do not assume the transition probability to be a Markovian process. In this DDIM paper, they construct a class of non-Markovian diffusion processes and find A and B that satisfy these constraints. This gives us these two Gaussian distributions. Interestingly, the sigma t can be set to arbitrary values. By setting them to zeros, we get a deterministic generated process. The only randomness comes from the initial sample noise. Here is the quantitative evaluation. With 1000 denoising steps, the DDPM did perform better. But when we reduce the number of denoising steps, the quality of DDPM quickly degrades, while the results from DDIM remain decent. The best thing is that we don't need to retrain the model. We just need to take the model trained with the DDPM objective and accelerate it with a DDIM sampler. But even with the DDIM sampler, it still requires quite a few steps. Let's further reduce the number of steps using distillation. We can use a pre-trained model as a teacher and teach a student denoising network to use one sampling step to reproduce the output of the teacher network using two sampling steps. So after this distillation process, we have the number of sampling steps. We can ask the student model to be a new teacher model and repeat the process until we reach the target sampling steps. Another idea is to distill classifier-free guided diffusion that requires evaluating both conditional and unconditional models into one single model. We can further apply previous ideas to make it faster, such as progressive distillation and latent diffusion models.
Wow!
We can distill a pretrained denoising network using consistency models. The main idea is to train the model so that for any points on the path, the model predicts the same origin. This supports single-step generation as well as multi-step generation. Applying consistency distillation in the latent space gives us high-resolution image generation using only a few steps. We can also extend the idea of latent consistency model with LoRa. But what's LoRa? Given a pre-trained model, sometimes we want to generate contents of particular style, such as pixel art, Lego, IKEA instructions, and anime. We can achieve these styles by fine-tuning the base model with additional data. However, this is computationally expensive and requires high storage. In many cases, it turns out we only need to fine-tune the cross-attention layers in the denoising network. We freeze the pre-trained weight W0 and optimize the residual parameters. But there are still a lot of parameters to update. We can reduce the number of parameters using low-rank approximation on the weight matrix. Therefore, we can accelerate the consistency distillation with LoRa. Here, the acceleration vector is the parameter difference between the distill and the base model. More interestingly, we can accelerate other fine-tuned models by linearly combining the acceleration and the style vectors. Here are some examples. Another recent distillation method trained the student denoising model using score distillation. However, these predictions are usually blurry. The main idea is to apply an adversarial loss by training a discriminator. Here are some results. After distillation, these models can achieve text-to-image generation at interactive rate. To sum up, we covered the training objective for diffusion models and their three interpretations. How we can guide the generation with classifier and classifier-free guidance. How we can synthesize high-resolution images using cascade, latent, and end-to-end diffusion models. And how we can speed up the sampling using DDIM sampler and various distillation techniques. Please comment below if you have any questions. Thanks for learning with me. I will see you next time.